Today on Typical Books, we're going to be talking about Withered by A.G.A. Wilmot. It is a typical book in that I fell in love with the cover very, very much. Now, this is like a YA type horror, so you might be wondering, why did I choose this book? Now, the cover and the plot, the summary of this book sounded so perfect to me. I checked to see if it was YA. I didn't check close enough. It seemed to be a straight up haunted house, haunted town, haunted past, coming of age sort of story. So I was sold. Lots of horror stories involving kids and teens and coming of age aren't YA books. So I figured this would be a fit for me. And when ECW asked if I wanted a review copy, I jumped on it. Now, I had seen this out in the wild, so I already wanted to read this, and to have a review copy was just awesome. So thank you very much, ECW, for sending this along. I have to say, I was more tempted by the cover art than anything. I really, really, really wanted to love this book. Not to say I didn't love it. I liked it, but liking and loving a book, you want to love every book, especially when it sounds so close to something that you want to be perfect horror. So the plot, basically, Ellis and their mom, Robin, move back to Robin's hometown. Of all the houses, it has to be the house where Robin's best friend, the former home of Robin's dead friend. Now, this is a house that has always been super haunted. And I like this premise. The house, even though it had been abandoned for 20 years and haunted for decades, struck me as like this bland kind of faceless. It was a little bit too modern for my taste. I think that from the premise, like the back of the book summary and what I had envisioned, especially from the front cover, I wanted a little more appealing wallpaper. And I don't know if that's a problem everyone has. When someone says haunted house, you think Marston House or Eel Marsh House or something like peeling wallpaper, old house, wooden banisters, creaky stairways and stuff like that. This isn't exactly that. Now, we learn that being kept up and clean is part of the haunting of this house, but I wanted the house itself to have a little more haunted house character. So from the back of the cover, after the tragic death of their father and surviving a life-threatening eating disorder, 18-year-old Ellis moves with their mother to the small town of Blackstone, seeking a simpler life and some space to recover. But Blackstone feels off. It's a disquieting place surrounded by towns with some of the highest death rates in the country. It doesn't help that everyone says Alice's new house is haunted. Everyone, including Quinn, a local girl who has quickly captured Alice's attention, and Alice is starting to believe what people are saying. They see pulsing veins in their bedroom walls and specters in dark corners of the cellar. Together, Alice and Quinn dig deep into Blackstone's past and soon discover that their town, and Alice's house in particular, is the battleground for a decades-long spectral war, one that will claim their family and the town if it's allowed to continue. So you can see why I had this backdrop of a very haunted old house when it's, you know, delving decades into the past of the town, and it does. It's got a really good flashbacks, sequences, and stuff that are woven really well into the modern-day story. So yes, that is there. The house itself is just kind of bland. The book has a bit of a sagging middle, too, with that twist. The tone changes in the middle of the book, and I found this was also the case with Waif by Samantha Kolesnik. But in that novella, it's kind of a fun change of tone. In this novel, it's a little bit destabilizing. I think that's because of the length. In a novella, you can sort of, like, play and experiment a little more. In a novel, when you're in for the long haul, having a tone shift in the center didn't quite work. I do love the introduction to the town, though. That's the part of the book I think I like most of all, even though it's a little bit oddly written, because it's probably because it's YA. Everyone talks in catchphrases. Not that I don't get them because I'm older, it's that I don't care for them. Early on, we get to live through the new kid in town first day, and that is kind of fun. We get to know the layout, what the town offers, and meet a few of the people. While being a little surreal and overly quirky, very like, I don't know what it is, like hipster, millennial kind of speak. And it's just not interesting to me, but it is my favorite part of the book at the same time. I don't know why. Now, the one thing I did find, and maybe it's a personal preference, I prefer a setting that is slightly overwritten. maybe because of all the time reading Anne Rice, so I can firmly paint a picture in my mind. The setting here relies on our own personal idea of a small town, I think, and it's not firmly drafted enough for me. On the other hand, we spend a lot of time delving into the intricacies of characters, sometimes ones that aren't particularly interesting to me. I probably would have preferred that the setting be written that intricately. And the character development is a little bit interesting, to say the least. I would have really preferred that sort of level be reserved for the setting itself. We rely on this sort of endgame thing that I don't want to spoil at all. And that is the end of the book is sort of the description of the town relies on the horrific elements being described later on. So we get a much more picture of what the book looks like in its throes of agony, I suppose, for lack of a better term, and not wanting to spoil anything. So later on in the book, what's described to us is what we remember of this town, and where I would have rather had a little more description of the architecture so I could have an idea of the where and when of this town. Perhaps the author wanted us to have like a picture of just any old town in our mind, but I need something else for it to work for me, because every little small town is different as characters in a book. So I would guess that it's like a typical Midwestern or Northeastern small town. Now the characters, aside from the main characters of Ellie and Quinn, we don't spend a lot of time with other people. The parents are all sort of cardboard cutouts, and a lot of the other kids in town or teenagers sort of fade in and out of the story. Now Ellie and Quinn, depending on your demographic, may be very interesting to you. They weren't to me, really. They spend a lot of time talking about their troubles and the sort of flirting, dating thing that they're doing, getting to know one another, and neither of those things are interesting to me. I'm not the type of person who gets a kick out of sitting as a fly on the wall during somebody's therapy session, and I'm not the type of person that likes to hang out when other people are flirting and getting ready to become a couple or make out or like things like that. Not interesting to me. So yeah, that's what a lot of the character development is in this book. So if that is your cup of tea and you're looking for a YA style horror that would blow your hair back, because there's a lot of that in Withered. So I wanted more horror maybe than meet cute. And we do meet somebody later on who is hinted at that there may be a ghost, and I wanted to spend so much more time with that person. They were only vaguely described, but they were as interesting to me as Lydia Dietz's character in Beetlejuice. And there's also Dominic, another character who it's kind of like the head of a paranormal investigation hobby team in town. A team of kids that are paranormal investigators. I keep describing them as kids, but I think that they're teenagers anyhow. So he is this like paranormal investigator hobby kid that kind of runs a club. I guess it's a club of kids that investigate paranormal happenings in town. So I wanted to follow that kid, but we spend a lot more time, of course, with Ellie and Quinn, obviously. One thing I did like about the problems that Ellie has as an unspecified eating disorder and a gender displacement are not superpowers. Nothing worse than a story that tries to inject supernatural abilities into real mental health issues, or even worse, turn them into a story's MacGuffin. Now, MacGuffin, because I dislike people using that term and not defining it, is an event, object, or character in a film or story that serves to set and keep the plot in motion, despite usually lacking intrinsic importance, according to Google. And while these issues of Ellie's lack intrinsic importance, unfortunately, because they sound like very important health issues and mental issues and just personality issues that somebody needs to come to terms with early in life, they sound very important, but they're really not, and they really have no effect on the plot whatsoever at all. Ellie could be anybody. And that's kind of good on one hand, isn't it? Right? Like, yes. But it feels weird. It feels pandering in a way to harp on these things that don't have any real bearing on the plot or their character necessarily. I like Ellie. I like Ellie despite or because of neither. All those other problems don't matter. They don't really shape who Ellie is as a person. I think Ellie's relationship with their mom, Robin, shapes it more, but Robin seems, like I said, a bit of a cardboard cutout. So now I've been reading a lot of small town horror. And this is a good one if you're into YA and you're into stories of non-binary characters with struggles, therapy struggles, new kids struggles, teenage struggles, if you will, and then paranormal struggles in this new town. If you like those sorts of angles in a book, then Withered is really for you. I'd be interested to see more A.G.A. Wilmot, more adult fiction perhaps, and try to focus more on setting than building characters this way, because I think they need to have a balance in to make a book work really properly. So if you are the new kid in town somewhere and you're sort of in this age range of 14 to 18 and this kind of thing appeals to you, then this may be a soothing read that would help you through those kinks, because somebody's got it worse than you, believe me. In Withered, that's the worst new kid in town experience I'd say ever. It does have a fulfilling ending from an emotional point of view and a moral point of view. And things do wrap up quite cleanly, and I like that. Some people might like know that I do love an ambiguous ending. I want everyone to have a terrible time, even right to the end, and it to get worse off screen. But this has a nice ending, if you like nice endings. I was sold by the cover art and the description of this book, so if it speaks to you as well, I have my criticisms, and if you think that even with those it sounds like a 4-star read, then go ahead and pick it up. If you're looking for more different small town horror that is similar, I'm reading Small Town Horror by Ronald Malfi, and I'll be reviewing that eventually, and I would like to recommend that already because I'm having a great time. I'll highly recommend Wasps in the Ice Cream by Tim McGregor and The Haunting of Velkwood, which I'll be talking about soon. That's Gwendolyn Keist's most recent novel, and it was fantastic. I enjoyed it so very much. I'd have to say that for classic horror, like Stephen King's Salem's Lot is maybe the sort of thing that with a town like this, a town having a secret, having to do with young teens, and it's a bit of a coming of age story, I think that that might be a worthy comparison, a little bit lofty. Not many books compare quite to Salem's Lot because it's a classic for a reason, but yeah, a loose comparison. If you've never read Stephen King and you read Withered and you want more like that, I would really recommend Salem's Lot. Double thank you to ECW for sending this review copy along. I enjoyed it quite a lot. I was very happy to have my curiosity fulfilled as well because I was very intrigued by this book. So have you read Withered by A.G.A. Wilmot, any more of their books, or are you looking forward to reading it for yourself? Let me know in the comments below. Thank you again for watching, and have an ooky, spooky day.